Kamani, a researcher at Oxford University. Samuel, always good to speak with you. So just how widespread was this hack?
Well, it appears as if this hack occurred over a period of a number of years. It originally extended towards dissidents within the UAE, but then it swiftly extended towards Qatar as well, where they were monitoring Qatari support for the Muslim Brotherhood, the Qatari royal family, and even FIFA for its support for the Qatar's World Cup ambitions. And then it broadened to something that was much more global in scope, including American officials and the First Lady of the United States, Michelle Obama.
Yeah, so what are the security implications for those who had their communications intercepted?
Well, it certainly was a major proximate cause, a long-term cause, for the escalation of the digital cyber war in the Gulf, which eventually culminated in the hacking in 2017 that led to the Qatar crisis. So in terms of the hacking and surveillance in the Gulf, that was probably where it was most pronounced. But it also created an uncomfortable rift in UAE-US relations under the Obama administration, especially as the CIA had given up spying on the UAE, whereas the Emiratis were spying on the Americans.
And what are we learning, do you think, about the capabilities of nations to be able to spy on one another using digital means? Are each nation kind of competing to try and outdo one another in their capabilities?
Well, there certainly is an ongoing cybersecurity competition in the Middle East that's between the UAE and Iran, as well as Qatar, and also through the interference of outside actors like Russia. So that's part. This is part of a broader competition in the cybersphere. I think what happened here was that it was less that the UAE was using profoundly significant new technology. It was more that the Emiratis were able to hire and poach NSA experts to overdo Abu Dhabi to work on their side by paying them three or four times what they would be paid in the U.S., offering them tax-free lifestyles, and then using them to turn against the United States. And unfortunately, when the surveillance extended towards Michelle Obama, these NSA workers felt that there was something wrong with this and then gave up on it. But still, they had free rein to spy on Qatar and on domestic dissidents. So that's a serious problem.
Well, that's fascinating elements of this, isn't it, Samuel? How common is it to hire sort of, I'd call them digital mercenaries to work for the state?
I imagine this is a rapidly growing phenomenon. It's obviously hard to get very firm statistics on this, but the UAE is expanding its surveillance capabilities across the world. I mean, Totalk, which is an Emirati social media app, has also been accused of being engaged in surveillance. And now there are legitimate concerns that the Emirati-Israeli partnership, if it does extend to surveillance technology, will lead to an expansion of these hirings and recruits. But I don't think this is the last story of this kind that we'll be seeing coming out of the UAE.
Yeah, perhaps not. Okay, Samuel Rahmani, always appreciate your analysis. Thanks for being with us.